Hi, I'm Toni Williams, and this is Brooklyn Savvy. Hi, I'm Toni Williams, and welcome to Brooklyn Savvy. We're going to be talking about mental illness today with Hakeem Rahim. Now, you are a mental health advocate, and we're also going to be visited with Susan Wiviott, and you are the CEO of The Bridge, which is a transitional home.
We're a nonprofit. We operate housing for people who are seriously mentally ill. We have 900 units of housing, and we also provide services, treatment services for people with mental illness and substance use disorders.
And I just want to thank you so much for coming on, because I'm looking forward to how you'll be able to help inform our audience. So thank you so much. And we have Lisa White. Now, you're semi-regular, but you are also a clinical social worker and just a savvy lady. I mean, we just love Lisa White.
Oh, thank you.
And then there's Denise Arbisu and Phyllis White Thorne. So when we're talking about mental illness, it's so broad. How do we distill that for our viewers, what it means to be mentally ill?
Sure. So if you want to go with a definition of it, mental illness is the illness of the brain. Mm-hmm. And most times people say illness of the mind, but we want to really bring it to the biological level. So illness of the brain. And it says it's caused by chemical imbalances. And mental illness can be genetic, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a genetic component caused by chemical imbalance that affects the way you think, the way you feel, and the way you behave. So there's all these different components to mental illness, right? So that's if you want to give a broad overview. Mm-hmm. And each mental illness has a behavioral, has a physiological, has an emotional component to it. So let's say depression, right? So we talk about depression, getting out of bed, you can feel sad and heavy. There's suicidal ideation, that goes to the cognitive component of depression. So each mental illness has those particular attributes.
So is there a chemical imbalance also related to depression, or is it something else that drives depression?
Well, yes. So there can be a chemical imbalance component to depression. Let's say we're talking about clinical depression. That has a chemical imbalance component. But you can also have depression stemming from grief or stemming from trauma. And that component, that can actually
That's emotional,
be emotional and environmental, can be environmental.
Is there a difference in the treatment of that in terms of, you know, once, can you say once temporary and once ongoing?
I think when you're talking about certain serious mental illnesses like schizophrenia or bipolar, they're chronic illnesses, the way that somebody might have diabetes. They don't go away. You don't cure them, but you certainly can manage them in a way that people can lead very happy, fulfilling lives. But they do need to be managed, and people do need treatment. A lot of the people that we work with also have had a lot of trauma in their life.
I think it's interesting, though, when one can look at it as a, in some respects, a chemical issue, because then, you know, it's something that can be treated, and in a lot of ways, you know, it's inherited, as you've said. Sure. Now, tell us about your story, because when we met a few months ago, I just found your work so intriguing. So talk to us about who you are and why you have come to be a mental health advocate.
Sure. So if I want to jump right in, I was actually diagnosed with bipolar disorder.
Let's talk a little bit about what that is.
Right. Sure. So bipolar disorder is a mood disorder. And there's two components to it. There's the high part of bipolar disorder, which is mania. And mania is where you're talking very fast, pressured speech, where you have delusions of grandeur. So for me, before I was hospitalized, I thought I saw Jesus on the corner at Harvard University. So I was an undergrad at Harvard University, and I had delusions.
So there are hallucinations as well with us?
Hallucinations as well with mania. So it can be hallucinations. So,
right. Now you said there was the mania piece, and then there was
the depression piece So my journey really began with mental illness when I was a freshman at Harvard University. First 2 weeks in the school, you know, it's the excitement. As a 17-year-old, 1998, going out for your first night on town, and boom, I was hit with an anxiety attack.
And I didn't know what that feel like? Right.
So,
because sometimes, you know, I wonder, am I having an anxiety attack? Because you can, anyone can have one.
Right. What is it? Right. So, mind you, this is 1998. We're not, right. Nobody's talking about mental illness. Now the conversation
It's all about that. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. So anxiety attack for me felt like sweaty palms. Mm-hmm. Your mouth gets really, really dry. Your stomach turns inside out and nauseous. Mm-hmm. It's like you're sitting in one mm-hmm. place, but your body is racing. Your mind is racing. Sometimes it feels like you're having a heart attack. So it's again, that bodily physiological.
How did you know you weren't having a heart attack?
I didn't.
Okay.
I didn't know.
Right.
I mean, I ran back to my dorm, and now this again, I was 17 years old at college, pulled the covers over me. I was shivering in fear, but I didn't know exactly what was going on. I had no words or vocabulary to put to what was going on with my body and mind.
So. Now, why is it, at least from what I've been reading, is a lot of these illnesses have an onset in the teen years? What's driving that?
I don't know that anybody really knows, but it does seem, for major mental illnesses, it does seem to be a time when it sort of manifests itself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think it's I don't know your family background at all, but, you know, one of the things that we find is that a lot of young adults who develop a major mental illness have a lot of problems with their families. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of stigma attached to it. Sometimes there's outright rejection of young adults who all of a sudden develop a mental illness. Sometimes they've been having difficulty already, and then it becomes diagnosed, and people understand what the issue is. But that tends to be the time when, I think particularly for bipolar and schizophrenia, that tends to be the time when it all of a sudden manifests itself and people recognize there's a serious problem.
And half of all lifetime cases of mental illness are diagnosed by the age of 14 and 3/4 by the age of 25. So that's why you see when young people go off to college, 17, 18, 19 is a classic age of diagnosis for young men and a little bit older for young women. So that's when you see your cousin goes off to school, your brother, your nephew, they go off to school, then come back like, was he taking drugs? Mm-hmm. What's going
what
on
happened?
With him?
What happened? Right.
And that's the actual age, that's the classic age of diagnosis.
But do you think that the experience of going away to school triggered it, or is that something that has, you know, like, I mean, what's that trigger point that releases that reaction, you know, that you might have a panic attack or that you're finally diagnosed correctly as to what you have?
So for me personally, I have mental illness that runs in my family on my mom's side. So there's depression, bipolar disorder. So I think that there was something that happened to me. So people ask, did you go to Harvard and then Harvard yard triggered, you know, bipolar disorder.
Right, you know,
I know people can be, you know, type A, but it's not going to trigger. And when I go into high schools, I speak at
but
high
doesn't,
schools.
But doesn't even being bipolar, don't you have a higher intelligence? I was reading somewhere where that also, that you tend to be smarter, a little bit smarter than other people. I've read some research this week. You don't know.
Right.
First time hearing that? Well, you're smarter.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
I think I've read that as well.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, they say there's a connection between creativity, intelligence, and bipolar disorder, schizophrenia. So that's where you see some of the greatest artists and some of the greatest musicians have diagnosis where they say Van Gogh and all these different creative elements. Mm-hmm. And there's also a creative element to mania. So people say the mania felt so good and I was so creative, and that's when I wrote some of my best poetry. I still remember the poetry from 15 years ago.
Right.
Because and that creativity and mania can be so addictive that it's hard to sometimes say, you know what? I need to manage my well-being, put my well-being in parallel to, maybe over and above, that creative energy and element.
So how is it impacting your relationships?
Yeah, people ask all the time. So I speak at support groups. Mm-hmm. I speak at NAMI, Family to Family Support Groups, National Alliance on Mental Illness. I'm sure you're familiar with that organization. And I have parents ask me all the time, so, you know, how are you doing in relationships, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that question is somebody going to love my child when I'm not here, right? Mm-hmm. But I think it's a very valid question. Mm-hmm. And for me personally, I say, listen, the divorce rate in the country, you had a show about divorce, is 50%, right? Mm-hmm. If you don't take care of yourself as an individual, You could have trust issues and somebody doesn't want to be with you.
Exactly.
But for me, I have to take care of myself, mental illness or not. Mm-hmm. And once you take care of yourself, relationships, I believe, are possible, mm-hmm. regardless.
You know, I just want to share personal information. My brother was diagnosed with schizophrenia. How, as a family member, do you give him the assistance in terms of he accepting that he has this? My whole family seems to deal with this in denial, in a manner of denial. And certain things can trigger a bad response, like the holidays.
Sure.
You know, the death of my mom last November. You know, like total denial that there's a family, or he insists that I'm his cousin when he knows full well I'm his sister. So it's these kind of things that, is that just him escaping? I mean,
or is it a symptom of the disease?
Is it that he's on the wrong meds? I mean, I don't know.
You know, you mentioned a couple of key things in there. First one is acceptance. You know, acceptance is the first piece towards wellness and recovery.
Meaning, as a person, you have to accept.
As a person, you have to accept. But also, our family members have to accept as well. But the first key to recovery and moving beyond, I believe, the symptoms is saying, yes, there's something wrong with me, and I have to get that treatment. I don't know how it's going to happen. At least for me, I didn't know how it was going to happen. Mm-hmm. But I came to a place of acceptance early. So I think that's one of the key first steps. Then you also asked about, so I believe, for me personally, I believe that each mental illness is different, right? So, and each person is different. So bipolar disorder will manifest itself differently in somebody else because we all have our personalities. So I think, and another thing, you know, language is important.
Personalities.
That person has bipolar disorder.
They're
not bipolar.
Right.
That person has cancer, is not cancer.
Right.
And each individual personality is different too. So the way your brother may manifest schizophrenia might also be a function of his personality.
Right. And maybe a fantasy or what have you.
Well, and the other thing I would say is that it is, you know, having your family accept it can be really important toward you accepting it, because you don't want to be rejected by your family. So 100%. That's really important. And I think that the support that a family can give somebody in terms of having them maintain their medication and their treatment is hugely important. I mean, I see the flip side of it sometimes, which is I see kids come to us, young adults that are living with us, that get, you know, start taking medication, become stabilized or doing well, and then have, you know, their families, and I understand this, will say, well, you don't really need that medication, you're doing really well, and they will stop taking it. And, you know, then you sort of see people regress again. So I think the support of family is so important, and the acceptance both of the condition but also of the treatment is really, really important.
And I think it's important to understand that for him, he's not receiving medication, and so because he's not receiving medication or taking medication, it changes the way he will articulate things, the way he perceives
his own perception,
his perception. And so understand that in some, that he really, whatever he's thinking he sees or he's experiencing is real to him. And so I think that goes back to just understanding that he may be articulating things that sound not, you know, like weird, but in reality, there may be some meaning in that. And so I think it's always, I think that goes back to just educating yourself on understanding more his illness. When you're in those scenarios or the situations with family members, it's important for you to understand what's happening for him and how scary it is for him as well.
Right. I just want him to be stabilized and fit into society and be happy, you know, and have a relationship. You know, he's 45 years old. You know, he's a young man, and he's a phenomenal artist.
But what you're saying about family support, because I know of a case with a young man who had the bipolar disorder, and the family hadn't seen him for 3 weeks, and they found him, and he was not alive. You know, so it's so important for there to be real family engagement and contact.
Could the reluctance of someone that is experiencing whatever these symptoms are, not want to own what might be wrong because of the stigma placed on, on mental illness. And, you know, one of the things that challenges, are there many other people that would reach out and get help and be able to really work with this, if you will, if the stigma wasn't there. Yes.
I think it's huge. Stigma, and, it's a huge... You,
and isn't your work all about that?
That's what you do,
that?
But it's,
yeah.
Right.
So,
it's a huge element.
So I share three key messages in my talks and my work. One, it's okay to talk about...
And your talks are the Let's Talk Mental Health,
that's
was
it?
That's
one of my talks.
Okay,
so
Let's
Talk Mental Illnesses I do in conjunction with NAMI Queens Nassau. Mm-hmm. And I go into high schools and middle schools and colleges. And I've spoken to over 20,000 students now. But I also do talks with people living with mental illness, family members. Mm-hmm. And the key messages I have is, one, it's okay to talk about what you're going through. Mm-hmm. Two, there's no shame in seeking help. And three, if you're diagnosed with mental illness, there's hope. And absolutely, stigma is a key component, making people feel abnormal because they're different. Mm-hmm. And that leads to barriers in getting jobs and housing. And you can talk to that probably even better on the ground, more better than I could in terms of how stigma is impacting
stigma
the people that you work
huge.
With.
It's I think, you know, people are so afraid to talk about it, and because I think maybe they don't know a lot about it, that's why education is so important.
And then the history, when you look at asylums and all of that, you know, when they start to conjure up those sort of images, it's really negative.
And maybe they think that will happen to them, or just being put in a hospital, you know?
Right.
And who wants to accept that you're different?
Right.
Who wants to think that you're different in some way?
And you know, it's so funny that the thing that everybody deals with every single day, which is mental health, is the thing that we have stigmatized. And we're made to feel that mental illness
That's interesting.
Yes, we're made to feel that it's outside of the human experience, when in fact, mental illness is part of the human experience. It's just on a different spectrum. So if we feel that, listen, and one of the things I say about for me is that I am not my label, I am not my illness, I'm my experiences, I'm Hakeem Rahim. And I think all these things about speaking about and being open about it wasn't easy for me. Don't think this is just a walk in the park. This has been 15 years of struggling, still struggling, putting my head in my girlfriend's lap and crying a couple of weeks ago. Now coming forward and saying, listen, you can go through it even 2 weeks ago and come out and say, listen, if I have the right treatment, if I have the right people around me, if I have the coping skills and support mechanisms, you can go through it and then come out the other end and, you know, be sitting here with Toni and all all the young ladies. Yes, exactly.
So we love that word, young. on the phone, we had talked about relapse.
Yes.
Now, what is that, and how does that impact your dealing with mental health?
So, you know, I would say that the way we think about how we deal with and live with our illness is even as important as getting the treatment for it, right? So relapse is getting symptomatic again, right? So let's say if you have you got a cold again, so that would be relapse, right? So let's say if you have bipolar disorder, a chronic condition that I have to manage, you have to manage. If you get depressed, that's a relapse into being symptomatic. It doesn't mean that you failed at living life. It doesn't mean that you failed living with the mental illness. It means that you've just had a relapse.
Right.
And you've become symptomatic. But the thing is that we often, because we associate our wellness with, okay, I'm symptom free. And living with mental illness, a chronic mental illness, there's a difference between saying I'm well and saying I'm better, right? Getting better. Right? So getting better, it's not a cold, it's not a flu. You don't take a pill and you don't get cured with some, right? But if you have
the
bereavement,
chronic,
yes, chronic. But the language is so important. If I'm well, I'm managing my symptoms, I'm taking my medicine, which I still take and I talk about, you know, and I'm exercising, I have my diet, I'm seeing my doctors, I have my med management. And if you do all these things, and I was very privileged because I had parents who accepted that I had a mental illness. I was at Harvard University.
Right.
I had structures in place.
And that's right. So it can be very, very
Hakeem,
different.
Are you saying that even doing all of those things that you just described, including the diet, the follow-up with the doctor and the medication, you could still have a relapse?
That's correct.
You could.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's correct. That's
and I think the important thing, heavy. You know, is that people don't feel like that's a failure. Yeah.
That's
no,
right.
It isn't.
Because,
right.
And even when you look at the sort of the medical, the healthcare system, the healthcare system wants cures.
Yes.
And I think one of the things that happens in our healthcare system is if you have a serious mental illness and you have a relapse, which does happen, you know, then it's sort of considered a failure. And it shouldn't be considered a failure. And I think that's...
Absolutely.
That's
and,
well,
and that's a component of how I think about what I go through is as important as what I go through. And people, as we talked about, people living with mental illness are so intelligent that if you reduce it to take your medication, go to therapy. No, how is this medication going to change me? How about my self-concept? How about who I am is going to be different or may be different because I'm taking these pills? So we have to really... I would say bring more nuance to the conversation around mental illness in order to, for acceptance for both individuals, as I think the broader society.
Well, you know, this is a great place to talk about the someone that you wanted to bring on the show.
Sure.
Zachary Dorsonville.
Sure.
And he has an app. So we're going to break and we'll bring back Zachary. Now, Hakeem, in our conversations, you've talked to me about the work that you have done with young people. And you mentioned this young man, Zachary Dorsonville. So if you can just kind of introduce him to our viewing audience, and then we're going to talk to you, Zach, about your journey and some of the really creative things you're doing.
So I met Zach about a month and a half ago, actually, very recent. And somebody through an organization called Fountain House introduced me to Zach. And he said, hey, this is an incredible young man. He's doing amazing things. And he just out of the blue emailed me. And I said, listen, I've had so many people pour into my life that I have to pour back and give back.
Absolutely.
So, so Zach, I don't know, you can share a little bit about your app and your journey and how you came to do that.
Yeah. Right.
So it all started when I was 14 in 2012. And I will never forget this night. My uncle came home from visiting my mom in the hospital, and it was my aunt's birthday, which is where the irony comes. So he brought my sister and I into the family room, and then he said, Tamara, Zachary, I went to see your mother today. And then I was like, so how is she doing? And he was like, well, I don't know if you're ready for this. I'm sorry to say this, but she passed away. Then I was like, are you serious? And then he was like, I'm so serious. And then I remember my sister sitting right next to me just burst into tears. She just started sobbing and letting out all of her emotions. And me, I just sat there. I had a really numb feeling. I felt like I was in a dream because I was like, how could this happen to me? Later that night, I was in my room. I made sure to wait till everybody was sleeping. So I was in my room on my bed, looking through some old photos of some moments and times we had. And then I just let it all out. I let all my emotions out. Everything like that, just thinking about how she was the only person in my life who had consistently loved me unconditionally, and I had unconditional love for her as well. So after her death, I started to experience symptoms of depression and anxiety for the very first time. And so my symptoms, at first I didn't want to admit that I had it, because as Mr. Rahim said, there's a stigma involved with that. I didn't want anybody to know I was having these problems because I wanted a sense of normalcy. And me dealing with this, it was a very rough time for me. I remember one time I was in my room and I started to have a panic attack, similar to Mr. Rahim's, as he explained it. My hands started sweating. My heart started beating extremely fast. I felt like I couldn't breathe. I felt like I was gonna die. So I went in the bathroom, I splashed some water on my face, but the problem persisted. So I don't think I got any sleep that night. From the depression standpoint, I just wouldn't be motivated to do anything. I knew what I wanted to do, but I just didn't have the determination to do so. So when you're depressed, the chemical imbalance of serotonin in your brain, you can't achieve what you want to achieve. You can't achieve your aspirations. You can't do anything that you want to do because you're constantly in this state of mind that, what's the point? What's the point of living? But I'm very fortunate that I have a sense.
Did you have a spiritual base? Meaning,
Absolutely. I talk to God a lot, and I also talk to my mom a lot, because I know that she's looking down for me on the gates of heaven, and I want her to be proud of me. That's why I'm doing all the things I'm doing. But I'm very fortunate to have a steady support system. More specifically, my aunt, she makes sure I take my medicine every day. She's making sure I don't sleep too much. It got kind of annoying, but I'm very fortunate, extremely fortunate, and I love her to death. If it wasn't for her, I wouldn't be anywhere near the person I am right now. I consider myself lucky sometimes because a lot of people don't get the help that they need and they just remain in the same state for the rest of their lives.
And lucky too, because you're now contributing to others through the app.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
So let's talk about that, the app.
What Recuperi is, it's a mobile app that provides an easy gateway for children and adolescents who struggle with mental disorders, an easy gateway to access a counselor via video call, phone call, or SMS messaging. I thought that since this generation is so fixated on technology and mobile devices that it would be very helpful if people going through a similar situation that I was going through would have access to talk to somebody whenever they need it right from their pocket. So teen suicide is it's like one of the leading causes of death in this country, and that's something I really want to reduce. So I feel like once I get this app out there, you know, with funding and things like that, it'll greatly reduce the teen suicide rate in America, which is one of my main goals for this app.
Well, you know, we're about to run out of time, but I'm so glad that you were able to join us and to share something that is really giving back. And before we close, and thank you so much, Zachary, if you could just talk a little bit about, let's talk the assembly programs that you do.
Sure. Mm-hmm. So. The work I do, I go into high schools, middle schools. That's the Let's Talk Mental Illness. I'm also actually working on a college tour, which is called the I'm Acceptance Campaign. So again, talking about suicide and mental illness, that's one of the main goals for me, is to how do we empower every college student to take control of their mental health. So I'm actually working on that to get that funded.
Excellent.
Well.
And yours is on GoFundMe?
Absolutely.
Go fund him. Anyway, this has been such an inspirational episode, I must say. I'm so proud of both of you gentlemen and the work that you're doing that's really helping to change lives. And Susan, thank you so much for the work that you're doing, and we're going to have you back to talk more about the bridge. So thank you all so much, and we will see you next time on Brooklyn Savvy.